Land Again from Space. This project is done in the Machine Elements Lab under the supervision of Professor Britt Boudreau. First, the table of contents. We will have some background information for to make sure that everyone's familiar with the topic, then the problem definition and design requirements. Then we go to the conceptual solution of the testing machine. Then the preliminary solution or design. And this is the main body, the preliminary design. And finally, we'll make a summary and conclusion. First, what the rolling bearings are. Rolling bearings are machine elements that is present in almost all the machinery around us, and they are quite important in reducing the friction during rotation. And as you can see, they have too many types and a lot of applications. But as a matter of fact, less than 10%, and some resources even say that 1% of those rolling bearings are able to last for this specified lifetime or service time. SKF, which is a common manufacturer or a well-known producer of ball bearings, made a thorough analysis, and it found that two main reasons of the failure are related to inadequate lubrication and fatigue due to loading and operating conditions. So this counts for about 70%. And therefore, we have the problem statement of the project. To build the bearing monitoring test machine for educational purposes, because it is necessary for students and researchers to be able to analyze and understand the behavior of the ball bearings under different conditions. First, the design requirements, which we obtain from the end customer, who is in this case the professor. First, the bearings should be changeable, so we can test different bearings. The machine should be user-friendly and compact, since the users are students. They are not scientists. And then we can change the speed from 500 RPMs to 3,000 RPMs, which is the same as 53 radians per second, to 314 radians per second. And then finally, the load should be changeable from 0 to 12 kilonewton at a 10-step resolution. So it's 1.2 kilonewtons for each step. The conceptual solution was provided by the supervisor, and we can very roughly divide it into four subunits. First, the mechanical power supply, which comes from the motor and the drive of the frequency converter behind it. Then the loading, which consists of this part. And as you can see here, the mechanism here is a screwed mechanism, but this is going to be changed. This was just a conceptual solution. And then the transmission, which consists of the shaft, those bearings as well, coupling and all other components, but they were provided by the supervisor based on the available resources at the lab. And then the vibration analysis. Maybe it is worth mentioning now to say that there are four main ways to analyze the ball bearings behavior: vibration analysis, ultrasonic, thermography, and visual inspection. Very briefly, but you can find detailed information in the report. We choose vibration analysis because it is cheaper and it is very well studied, a very old method. And finally, it covers a wide range of defects. So those defects which appear from bad lubrication, from overloading, from inadequate installation, so they all can be fixed using this method. But unfortunately, I didn't have time for covering this part of the project, but it is part from another project. Then to choose the right motor and frequency converter, we need to know the needed power. And this is the part where we do a lot of calculations and spend a lot of time. I'm not going to dive deep into it, but it is all present in the report, so you can have a look into it. But the first, the main two steps is to the first one is to find the viscosity, and this is usually you follow a certain step to find the standard viscosity and the ISO standards, and then to find the actual operating viscosity depending on temperature and so on. But it is important to get it to. It depends on the condition of the bearing. The bearing isn't expected to have perfect lubrication, but it should be in the standard range to be able to test it. And then the frictional moment, and it has three main components. Actually, it has other components, but those are the ones that present unusual industrial ball bearings, or actually all the rolling bearings. Like for example, there's drag and other, but they don't apply for the commercially available bearings. So very quickly, without going into the calculations, there's the seams and seam friction. As you can see here, usually ball bearings or rolling bearings have seams, and this is the friction that takes place between the seams and the race of the bearing. Maybe if someone's interested to look at this boring thing. And this part also is the stabilizing bearing block. And then we have the sliding friction, which happens between the sliding at the start and during the rotation as well, between the balls and the race, and the outer and inner race. And finally, the rolling friction. We add those three together, and we get something like, something like 333 newton meters. And then we can calculate the needed power. All the calculations are done for based on the SKF catalog for a double throw, so we can see two rows and deep groove pull bearings. So for other types of bearings, the calculations are going to be different, but they should stay in the similar range as long as they are of the standard commercially available rolling bearings. So using standard equations, we can find the power and then add the needed power for all the components. We have two loading bearings. We have one stabilizing bolt as the one you just got. And finally, we have the testing bearings. So that gives something like 455 watts. But before, now we have the power, so we can select the motor. But before doing that, we do a small verification for the SKF approximation formula. The formula, as you can see, is quite simple. It is for finding the moment of friction due to sliding and rolling. This is one constant, you get it as it is, you don't do any kind of calculations. This is the effective load, and in our case, it is a radial loading, so it is the same value, 12 millimeters, and this is the diameter. We do the calculations, and we get 0.8 millimeters. If we do the same, using those very long calculations that I did, and using the same standards and very time-consuming issues, we finally get to the same result. 18 newton meters, so this could have saved a lot of time and a lot of effort. So something like 1 month work could have been saved using this formula. Then now we select the motor and frequency converter. But before doing that, if we just say okay, we need 450 watts, then we just select the motor with 0.75 kilowatts. This is the first thinking, but it wouldn't work because if we draw the needed torque over the nominal torque graph, plot it against the speed, and we'd find that we can start this thing. And before that, on the right, we have the drive characteristics or the frequency converter characteristics. On the vertical axis, we have the ratio between the load that the motor can provide, or the motor and drive can provide, divided by the nominal torque, again, plotted against frequency. And we are using curve one. This is the usual characteristics. So if we combine those two graphs together, we find that for a motor of 0.75 kilowatts, we can start this thing from some value around 2000 RPMs, which doesn't meet the design requirements. We need to start this thing from 500 RPMs. So we compose a comparison matrix. We have three different motor powers, compare them. As you can see, the criteria is here: power, price, efficiency, nominal speed, shaft diameter, so that whether we can connect directly the shaft through the coupling, or do we need to design some kind of special part? Because as you can see here, the shaft is about 14 millimeters, but here it's 19 millimeters, 19, 24, so it's not. We will need to design a part for it. So, and finally, and most importantly, the minimum loading speed. For a motor 1.5 kilowatts, we have a minimum testing speed of 500. So that that meets the design requirements very feasibly. As you can see, it's not very costly. So we choose the last motor with highest power. This is the chosen motor and chosen EBB drive frequency converter. Then we move to the loading mechanism. As you saw in the conceptual solution, we can load it using the screw mechanism, or we can use load it using some dead weight, or we can use a hydraulic jack, or finally as a pneumatic cylinder. For sure, there are other many ways to load it, but those were the four feasible ones. that as far as I believe. Okay, then we compose another comparison matrix. We put the price, possible load, compactness, mobility, and design simplicity. The simpler the design, the less errors we can have. So very intuitive. That did win, but a very low score, as you can see, because it is quite hard to find 1.2 tons and put it on the machine. The screw mechanism is somehow quite complicated to build, so it was excluded as well. But hydraulic drive, it can apply up to 50 kilometers, quite high. It is it's very compact, just something like that. And it is not hard to mount, so it seems like a perfect choice. So we choose it. But after contacting different manufacturers, we reached the conclusion that after one or two strokes with the hydraulic jack, we are up with 50 kilonewtons. So this means we have a resolution of two or three steps, which doesn't meet the design requirements again. So we move to the next candidate, which is a pneumatic cylinder together with the compressed air source we have in the lab. And as far as we are, there's no problem with it. We draw the circuit. We have three main components, pressure regulator, valve, 5-2 valve, and double acting cylinder. And then now we go to the final step for this course, for this semester. We need to do the loading mechanism. But before going to the loading mechanism, there was a small problem with pneumatics. It was said on the manufacturer's website, Pisto, that it is recommended to have something like 15 to 20 percent safety or margin. So this makes up a problem, since we cannot be sure 100% about the load we are applying, because depending on the condition of the cylinder, depending on the some other friction that happens in the circuit, we are not sure about getting the value that we require. So we use a loading cell. But the loading cell depends on the application of the load. Is it a pulling load or a pushing load? Actually, it doesn't matter, as long as it is a radial loading. So we, at first, we thought of having a pulling loop. Why to have a pulling loop? Because if we use a wire, we can compensate for any misalignments. Instead, if we are pushing, then it should be directly aligned. But if there's a wire, it can compensate for misalignments. So we choose the loading cell, the cylinder, and this is the root end. But as you can see, there are huge adjusting blocks, which means mass, manufacturing problems, and other issues like cost. So we make another design. We change the loading instead of pulling to pushing. So, and we change the type of the loading cell, which is going to tell us how much force we have. And then, but still, we have adjusting blocks, and they can cause some kind of parallelism issues. If the surfaces aren't perfectly aligned, this is going to give the unfavorable results. Finally, we get rid of this adjusting block by moving the cylinders down and mounting them using bolts. And then we need only to use one adjusting block. Here's the motor, this is the coupling, this is the stabilizing bearing, like the one you have. This is the adjusting bearing, and this is the cylinder trim. For sure, there are other designs, but they are all anti-port, so you can have a look at the anti-port applications for presentation. First, now we got the summary and conclusion. We have some kind of safety margin in all for all the design requirements. The cylinder can achieve force up to 16, for example, kilonewtons, but we need only 12 kilonewtons. Then we go to the limitations. First, the speed would depend on the lubrication of the testing bearing, and that is not desired, since we need to be able to test all different types, but there should be limitations anyway, which we will work on it for the next iterations. Future improvements, encoders and simulations. As you can see, we have a lot of uncertainties. We're not quite sure if everything is going to work as expected or not. So simulation could really help much reduce those uncertainties and help us make a better decision. Simulation can be done for the circuits and for the whole assembly in LabVIEW, for example. Encoders are important because, again, we have uncertainties, so they can help answer those questions. Finally, we have the conclusion. Effectiveness of transformation formulas, we should always look for them. They reduce time, unless we need some kind of very, very accurate results. Engineering design process is iterative and constructive. You build the design, you make another iteration, compare the design requirements, you make another iteration, compare it, and then you're going to make it. And it is constructive. You cannot build it from the scratch. You have to build on what others did before and learn from what they did. Finally, the importance of engineering experience. It is important to have someone giving you guidelines on how to channel your effort. Asking questions would help you think of what should be done next. That could save a lot of work that can be done for no point. This is all for me for now. You can find all the details that you would like to have in the report. Those are the references. Thank you for listening, and all questions are more than welcome now.